So, Advent of Code, that you have, is it big enough in the back? Okay. So, Advent of Code is an advent calendar of small programming puzzles. And you can solve them in any programming language you like. It's a little bit like the Perl Weekly Challenge Mohammed is running at the moment. But it's Christmas themed and only running during Advent, so like the month before Christmas. Looks like that, so it's a little bit Christmassy, green and silver this year. And so every day in Advent there's a two-part riddle and a competition who can solve those riddles fastest. Each user gets some personal input, so you have to register there to prevent cheating. And all of this is embedded in some sort of Christmassy story. So for example, this is the first day. You get this thing you have to do, you have some input. So in this example, you have to calculate some frequency changes and get a result. So everybody, as I said, gets some personal puzzle input. That was my input, just a long list of numbers. And the job was to basically just sum up those numbers. So it was very easy, of course, to solve. You just loop through the standard input, increment it, and output the result. Simple one-liner results in something. And then, oops, sorry, if you take a look at this input thing in the end. So here you get your personal puzzle input, and then here you have your submit form where you can submit your personal answer. So you sum it up. Get a result, I submit it, it's correct. Nice, perfect. Oops. Ugh. So then there's the second example, which you cannot read in the back, I guess. So what is the first frequency your device uses twice? Okay, so now we need to find the first value that's calculated twice. So it's easy, we just store the sum of the hash and break when we see the sum, like this. And the result, of course, is nothing. So I was like, what? So the first thing I learned in here, so if you read this thing a little bit more closely, you see in here, you might need to repeat the list of frequency changes many times before actually finding a duplicate frequency. So instead of just running through this thing once, you have to run it in a while loop until you hit the result. So I get this result, it's correct. And the first thing I learned, reading specs is very hard. Yeah, maybe not that. That's also some sort of a competition. For each task, you get one star. And per day, there are two stars for the first and for the second riddle. And as this is a competition, the first 100 people on the world to get this who solve a problem get some points. The first person gets 100 points, 99 points, and so on. And so there's some sort of leaderboard where people can you see the results. We cannot see the results because the contrast is very bad. So those are the first 100 users to get both stars on the one. So they solve both of those issues or problems. And what you cannot read here is 1 minute and 48 seconds. So like the winner took 1 minute and 48 seconds to read the spec, read it correctly, implement the solution, read the second spec, read it correctly, implement the solution, post it. So the thing I learned, some people are really very, very fast at doing that kind of stuff. Apparently there's some sort of sub-genre of programming called speed programming, where people just practice doing these things, they have algorithms and everything. I'm not one of them. So this is my score. Which is a little bit confusing. So what? That's not. It didn't take me 8 hours to solve this problem. I solved it at 8 o'clock, and then. You can see the difference between those two timestamps. So it took me 11 minutes to solve the second problem, which is not so good. because so the slowest thing I could have. It's like 5 minutes and 28 seconds. Would be the lowest time I could have been to get some points. Okay. But even this wouldn't have been enough if it would have been that fast. Because another thing, time zones are important. Of course, you know that as programmers, but at least especially if you want to get points, because the riddles go online on midnight EST. It's UTC minus 5. I live in UTC plus 1. So that's comfortable. It's a good time zone for the guy who runs the show. I live in UTC plus 1, so it's 6 o'clock in the morning. And no way I will get up at 6 o'clock in the morning to win some internet points. But some people do. So another thing I learned is that Reddit helps a lot. So there's a subreddit for the advent of code. Oh yeah. And as soon as all points of one day have been won, people post solutions and discussions there. And it's very interesting, very fun, very helpful, because I never managed to get even close to some points. And it's also very fun because, of course, people have a lot of crazy solutions. I mean, there's some people who just want to do it as fast as possible to get some points, and then there are some people who do crazy stuff. For example, Smilers, which you maybe know, London Perl Guy, UK Perl Guy, did a few tasks in Vim. So not in Vim script, in Vim. Okay? So you could type this into your Vim to get a solution for this, for the first day, for example. Yeah? Or some guy, so on the third day you had to find a two-dimensional plane that doesn't overlap with the other areas, and one guy read the data into an SQL database and then used geo spatial overlap to find a solution. So that's the SQL query to find a solution. Very easy, recursive, and everything. But yeah, fun. Of course, those solutions are fun, but they never win points. But yeah. My solutions were not fun. And not fast, or simple and put fast. So for example, let's look at day 9. So in day 9, Marble Mania, there was some stupid games the elves were playing where they had to pick some marbles in a cycle and put them back, and sometimes you take some marbles out and win some points. What's also interesting here, you see that you always have some test input and some examples of what you should produce. So that's sort of helpful. So something with marbles and the ring. You take marbles, you put marbles back. Told already, that's the example. And also, what's also very nice about advent of code is that you have the real data, which can be quite a lot and take a long time. And there's also some example data and some expected results. So for example, you have this thing where you say, okay, if you have 10 players and you input that thing, you should get that out. So you have some test values which you can use to fine-tune your algorithm or your script before you try to solve the real problem. So another thing I learned is to use this test data. I didn't write actual tests. I've just learned that some people did that. But I just stored the data in external files. So I have the solutions for this day, and the original data and the example data. So I could just easily check the test data if my solution works. And if it does, I can use the real data and then submit it. Because if you submit the wrong solution, you get blocked for a few minutes, which for the speed coders is interesting. And of course, you can brute force and just guess some stuff. So on the 9th day, there was no input file, but there were some input parameters, the number of players and the value of the last marble. So you fetch those from the command line. And here's my solution for this first part. I won't go into too much detail. It's basically the circle of players is an array, and the rules placing marbles, you use modulo and splice to put some stuff into the array or take it out. Yeah, so if modulo every 23rd player takes out a marble, so if it's modulo 23rd, take something out and let's put something in. Very easy, very, it doesn't take a long time to run. Fast and correct, nice. So on to the next part. Amused by the speed of your answer, the elf is a curious. So what is the number is 100 times larger. So nice, I just need to change the input parameters. Add 2 zeros to it and be done with it. So the code runs. Whoops. So okay, maybe I do need to change some things in the code. And on Reddit, everybody's talking about double linked lists. I know in theory what double linked lists are. It's like the first thing in the algorithm with Perl book, but I never used one. So I was sort of surprised that the regular is not enough here. And also, I know nothing about algorithms. I'm doing chasing in, chasing out database stuff, and I don't have to do any algorithm work all the time. Never, hardly. So, yeah. But it could be handy to know some algorithms. So linked lists, the plain list array doesn't work because we're doing a lot of inserts in the middle of the array, and arrays are not very good at that. They are okay if you add something to the end or the beginning, in the middle, not so good. Because you basically have to generate the array anew every time, and if the array is very long, it takes a lot of a long time. And in a double list linked, every element knows which one comes next and before. So it's very easy to insert a new element in the middle of the array if you have the element at hand. So you have this list, and you have this new thing, and you want to insert it in there, so you just change those arrows, and you're done. In Perl, it could look like that. So you have this head thing, the first thing, which just points to itself. So the previous and the next element are pointing to the same thingy. And then later on, when you add some stuff, you get a new one. You point it to the next element. You have next the previous thing of the next element is the new element. So you have this pointed back on itself. And then you, from the current thing, you get the previous element. And set the next element of the previous element to the thing you're just currently doing. So you're just linking it around. It's a little bit, but it's in the end, it's easy. And using that, I got the runtime down to 9 seconds. Not fast, but fast enough. It finished and was correct. So yeah, and I learned something. So on day 11, there was a 2D matrix with 300 by 300 fields. Each field had some kind of power level, and you need to find a 3 by 3 by 3 area in this big matrix with the highest power level. So you need to sum up all of those fields. So it looks like that. And this is this 3 by 3 area. You have to sum it up and then find the highest solution. So I solved it easily via some brute force, which is calculating the value of each of these fields and going through all of those fields. So it's like a for each, another for each, and doing it all the time. Sum up those ones, sum up those ones, and then get the total value of this thing. So that was not very fast. But it was good enough for the first part. And again, the second part now asks for an arbitrary large square with the largest value. So instead of looking for a 2 by 3 by 3 square, you had to say, OK, 3 by 3 square is good enough. No, maybe the 4 by 4, 5 by 5, 127 by 127 for all of those fields. So there was a lot of looping. And so that's my stupid brute force implementation, which took 2 hours. So I started in the morning, let it running in a Teamwork session, went to the office, some other stuff, and then went to Reddit later on. And then I learned something new, something called summed area table, which is some mathematical magic thing, apparently used a lot in image processing and graphic stuff. And the idea is that you have this matrix, and you just go through it, and you sum up the values. So you have -3 and 4, that is 1, so you write 1 into that field. Then you take, again, for the next field, you take the previous field, so -1 and 2 is 3, so you get 3 in there, and then you just go through the first row and sum up those values. For the second row, you take the one you have there and the one on top of it, sum it up, and then here, because of math, I don't know, you have to take the current value, the one to the left, the one to the top, sum it up, and subtract the one to the top left. Yeah, and then you go through this thing, which is a very easy one-time loop. You just go through it, and you can sum this. You can calculate this summed area table. It's easy and fast. And now, when you have that, and you want to have the sum of one area, you just take the lower right corner value, add the one outside the box on the left, add the one on the top, and subtract the one on the opposite side, outside of the box. And again, because of math, this works. You can go to the Wikipedia page, and that's a problem with Wikipedia and math. If you don't know math, you won't understand a thing. So it was a little bit hard to figure out what's going on, but it's working. But I didn't implement this because my brute force solution was already done. It was way faster to have the brute force implementation solve the problem than to learn all of this shit. I only learned it for giving this talk. But anyway, so day 12, subterranean sustainability, there was something about pots and growing plants and growing more plants, depending on if there are other plants left or right to them. So it sounded like Game of Life, which you maybe know. So this is like the first generation of pots, and then there's some algorithm that decides if some more plants grow or not. So you go through these generations and you iterate, And after some time, you have the final result. It was very easy to implement the algorithm, very fast to solve. Nice. So and now part two was again, what would it look like after 50 billion generations? Okay, I've been there. So my code, of course, will take forever. So I'm obviously missing an algorithm again. So I go to Reddit, and I learned it's a trap. There is no algorithm. But Game of Life has these things called gliders or spaceships, which basically are like recurring patterns, which just keep their shape but move in space. It's very fun. And if you look at the output of this script, you realize that the difference between the values basically stays the same. So we sort of have a glider. So you see the value increments, but after some time it stabilizes and always increments by 15. So we have a glider or something like that, which means we can abort and just extrapolate. So after 100 generations, I begin to check and see if the difference stays the same. And if the difference stays the same, I just abort and calculate the total sum by taking the current sum plus the difference per step multiplied by the missing generations up to 50 billion, which was very, very fast and also correct. So then there was this thing where they have this map of cards going through a subterranean tunnel. Think Raiders of the Lost, Temple of Doom. Yeah. Indiana Jones Temple of Doom, I have these cards going around. And you need to figure out where they crash. So this is the input, and they move, and if they hit something like that, they turn around and move to another track. So here's a live demo with the test data. No. So yeah, it's a little bit small. You see this small A and B's moving around. And after some time, they crash. And yeah, you need to figure out where they crashed. It was the first task. Where will be the first crash? Of course, the sane way would be to implement it using some sort of array and move those things around. But I was not in a sane mood, so instead of doing that, I implemented it using regular expressions. So you have this map as a big string. And then you move like one of those cards from one place to the right. You just say, okay, find any character and replace it by itself with the minus. Yeah. And the right part is, of course, a function because it depends on if you're hitting one of those turning points where it has to move up or down, you have to do something else. Anyway, and to move up and down, you just find a pipe followed by the width of the game board, followed by a letter, and again replace it by itself. Worked good enough with the demo, but with the live data, I don't know, there was some problem because apparently it depends on the timing in which card moves is also relevant. So you have to move this card first and that card first, and my regex didn't do that correctly. But just to give you an impression of the thing, so this is the live thing. So you see, it's a little bit bigger than the test data. And maybe, yeah, you see some of those moving around here. One is moving around here, and one is moving around here. Yeah, yeah, like backward. Yeah, so of course, when I run it, I don't have to sleep in between, so it goes whoop, and then it sort of hangs. Anyway. Oops. So, but then the task got more and more complex and more cumbersome and annoying and felt more like work. So another thing I learned, stop when it's not fun anymore. another thing I learned when I embedded the tasks for this talk, embedded them using an iframe. So I had to look at the HTML source code of the web page, and I found the following comment in that saying, you cannot, if you look at the source of the HTML code, you won't find any cheats, and it doesn't matter, don't look at the source code. But there was this thing, it's running on some custom Perl code. So yay. So the website powering this thing is running on Perl. It was nice. So yeah, it was very fun. I'm looking forward to next year. Thank you. Here's my very bad solutions. You can find a lot of more interesting solutions in the subreddit over there. That's the page of Edwin of Code. And of course, there's Perl Weekly Challenge, which is something similar for Perl. Any questions or and or? Oops, how do I get out of this thing? Okay, two questions. Okay, yeah. Did I consider using an SQL table instead of a linked list? No. But I guess there are some solutions like that online. Okay. Yes?
In the advance of code, you can create a group, and you can invite people to your group, and then you can compare just your score. So if you create a group of people living in the same
time zone,
it's no problem on the other clock anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
So that,
European. I was thinking about that, but then it was like. Anyway, but I think exactly. Next year we should have a European Perl group on Advent of Code because. So, for example, this is the web page, and here you see like the total participation stats, which in the beginning that was the first day where you had to just sum up the stuff, and as you see, there are fewer and fewer submissions because some of the solutions are like, you have to implement like basically a compiler for an assembly language. Reverse engineer it to find bugs, and it was. You solved everything. Yeah. Okay, good. So maybe you should have to give the talk. but how long did it take for some of the solutions?
Yeah, the last 3 or 4 days were totally.
Yeah, so that few days actually were already Christmas holidays and stuff like that. Yeah, but you see my track record was a bit sketchy in the end. And this is, for example, the leaderboard for the 13th day, which you really cannot read because the contrast is horrible. But as you suggested, you could have private leaderboards, even per company. So you could also have, for your company, have a leaderboard and compete inside your company. Okay. Okay, that's it. Yeah, thank you.